Today, I'm going to take you behind the scenes of what it's like to work on a $6 billion investment banking M&A transaction. What's up, everyone? My name is Ben, and welcome to Rare Liquid, a channel where I draw from my experiences as a former JP Morgan investment banking analyst to cover videos about tech investing and career advice. In case you're new to the channel, I post videos about tech investing on the weekdays and videos about career advice on the weekends. With that said, today's agenda looks like this. I'll first give you the background behind the deal that I worked on. I'll then talk about what I did as the analyst. And lastly, I'll discuss three insider secrets. This video will be a part of my investment banking playlist on my channel. So check that out if you're interested. I have some videos about how much bankers make, why I left investment banking, a day in the life of an analyst, and things like that. All right, so first up, let me give you some background behind the deal. An M&A or mergers and acquisitions transaction is pretty much exactly what it sounds like. You're helping your client either buy another company or asset, or you're helping a company sell itself or some of its assets. During an M&A deal, an investment bank pretty much runs the entire process just as a realtor would during a house sale. And obviously it's just really helpful to have an experienced party run the entire process for you if you're selling the house or company, let's say, to get you the highest possible price. And if you're trying to buy, then the lowest possible price or the best deal. In investment banking, you're either on the buy side, which means that you're helping your client buy a company, or you're on the sell side, which is where you're trying to help the company sell itself or its assets. For this deal that I was working on, Medtronic was our client. And if you're not familiar with them, they're the largest med tech company in the world. Their market cap is somewhere around $167 billion. We were helping Medtronic sell its medical supplies business, and this was the largest asset sale that Medtronic had ever done in its 68-year history. So this was a really big deal for not only the client, but also our MD and just the overall group that I was in at JP Morgan. We were co-advisors to this deal with another bank called Piper Jaffray, and it's kind of common sometimes for these really large transactions to have multiple advisors. And basically our job as the investment bank was really to reach out to as many potential buyers as possible and have Medtronic sell its assets at the highest possible price. And as banks, you're incentivized to also do this because you get a percentage of the total transaction. So the higher the transaction price at the end when you're actually selling, the more you earn in fees. Next up, let me give you some info about what I did for the deal as an analyst. The very first thing that happens to you as an analyst is you get an email from your staffer that says that you'll be working on a transaction. And when I got this email, I basically was like, okay, this is going to be a big transaction. I'll probably work 70, 80, 100 hours a week for the next few weeks. And I'm not gonna really have that much time for anything else. The following day, my associate and I would meet at my managing director's office, and he would give us the rundown of who the potential interested buyers were, what the process was gonna look like, and what kind of analysis we would need to be doing. And in this particular deal, we had both strategic buyers and financial sponsors, AKA private equity firms, interested in the asset. And so basically what this meant was we would have to do our standard valuation analysis, which was trading and transaction comps and discounted cash flow analysis. But for our financial sponsors, we also had to do a leveraged buyout or LBO analysis. In case you are interested in learning more about trading comps, you can check out this video I made here. And then if you're interested in learning more about discounted cash flow analysis, you can check out this video here. Also, if you want to really dive deep into financial modeling, I highly recommend checking out the Investment Banker course at Financial Edge. The founder, Alistar, is literally the instructor who taught me and hundreds of other analysts during my summer training at JP Morgan. And he's this British guy who has a really, really great, good-natured personality and cares a lot about being a good teacher. Financial Edge is a sponsor for this video, but I recommend this course to anyone who's interested in investment banking because I really think it's the best product out there. Their instructors train the analysts at the top four banks who pay tens of thousands of dollars, if not more, and you can get the same lessons for just a few hundred dollars and learn at your own pace. So I really think that this course is worth it. You'll learn everything that I learned during my training, including accounting, valuation, DCFs, LBOs, and a lot more. If you are interested, check out the link in my description below because then you can get 25% off. But anyway, going back to the transaction, this was back in around 2017. So I was about 2 years into the job, but I'd actually never built any LBO analyses except during training. And so what's kind of funny slash interesting about this whole situation was that Medtronic was paying JP Morgan millions of dollars for this deal. And for an analyst who had pretty much never run the analysis that he was running for this like huge $6 billion deal. Of course, they never really knew that. And I would also say that this happens all the time in banking, where analysts or even associates sometimes get thrown into the fire and into situations that they haven't really been in before. And in my situation, the associate I was working with was really sharp and thorough. She checked all the work that I was doing as associates do. And so there was never really a huge risk that things would go wrong. Most M&A deals are done within a super, super short time frame, and so I had to build out a draft of the LBO model by the next day. So I think I remember staying around until like 3 to 4 a.m. that night working on the model. And I remember I was also just looking at my old teammates' LBO models to kind of get a feel of what the structure should be and what kind of assumptions I need to include in there, how to build out the switches and the flexibility for the model. I was also even going on YouTube and Googling concepts that I didn't know. So really, I was kind of learning as I was building. The rest of the valuation work that I had to do, the trading comps, transaction comps, DCF, were things that I'd already done before, so they were relatively easy or straightforward. And so the rest of my responsibility for this transaction was really just building out the presentation for the upcoming meeting with Medtronic's CFO. This was probably the coolest part of the transaction for me, and it's because during that call, since it was such a high profile deal, we had the global healthcare JP Morgan vice chairman on the call, a lot of senior MDs, the Medtronic CFO and Medtronic's team, you know, all these people who were paid millions of dollars to, you know, do whatever work they do. And I got to listen in on how they thought about the whole transaction, overall industry strategy, how to negotiate, what they thought they could do to increase the competitive tension within the whole deal making process. And so, yeah, it was just a really interesting discussion. And of course, I was just on mute, not saying a single word. Nobody knew who I was pretty much on that call, except the team, the MDs that I was working with. So yeah, that's pretty much a summary of the transaction and what I did. I would say that this is a very, very simplified version. I think what's, you know, really hard to explain is just all the detail of, you know, for example, our LBO model that we had. I probably sent it back and forth 30 to 40 times, if not more, with my associate and the team, and also with the presentation that we were building, because we would have to change our assumptions all the time. We would have to see if we could increase the price, if we got like a higher bid from one of the potential buyers. And so there was a lot of back and forth, a lot of other parties involved, like the legal teams and the other bank that we were working with, the management team. So there's a lot of coordination and stuff that involves that is involved in an M&A transaction. But yeah, I don't want to bore you with all of those little tiny details. Ultimately, the transaction was announced on April 2017, and Medtronic sold its assets for $6.1 billion to Cardinal Health. We helped draft the press release, and all the major news outlets published the articles about the transaction. So I guess this is one of the cooler parts about banking, is that you get to work on these deals that transform companies and industries, and some of them, I guess, get somewhat worldwide attention. Before moving on to the next part of the video, I would really appreciate if you could help support the channel by smashing that like button, and feel free to subscribe if you haven't already. Next up, let me share with you some insider secrets about the M&A process. The first one is true amongst all well-run M&A processes, and that's that competitive tension is manufactured. In most M&A transactions, there are two rounds of bids, and it's pretty much like an auction process, but it's all blind, meaning that nobody knows what the other person is bidding. And in the first round is basically where we get all the potential buyers and have them do their valuation work and submit their first round bids on what they want to buy the company or asset at. Then the bank on the sell side part of the transaction, which in our case was JP Morgan for Medtronic, would evaluate those first round bids, which pretty much just meant, okay, who are our top bidders? And all the ones that are kind of lowballing or don't seem like they're really super interested based on their offer, they would be cut, and we would have a second round with a smaller pool of interested buyers. At this point in the second round, the companies who are involved as potential buyers usually are super, super interested in the asset. And just imagine yourself if there was only one, I don't know, car that could be bought amongst you and five other friends, and you had to write down on a piece of paper what your bid was, and you were in the second round, so a bunch of other people were cut. And you don't know what anyone else is gonna bid, but you really, really want that car, right? So you're incentivized to put as high of a price as you can without going way too over what the actual car is worth. So if you're a good banker, then you understand this whole process, right? And so you wanna manufacture as much competitive tension as you can. And you can't necessarily tell the buyers, you know, hey, your bid is too low, we have another bid that's offering higher. But you can kind of subtly slip them information about, hey, your bid's not competitive enough. If you're gonna want to actually buy this company, it should be higher. You know, I've never been a managing director myself, of course, and been in those discussions, but this is kind of stuff you hear in the grapevine. And so, yeah, that's what you do as a really senior banker. And the ones who make a lot of big bucks, and the reason why banks get paid so much is that they can kind of create this competitive tension to increase the transaction price at the very end to as high as it can possibly be. So tying this all back to Medtronic and Cardinal Health, basically the $6.1 billion that Medtronic got, you know, they were our client and they were super, super happy with this because this was kind of on the high end of what they thought that the assets were worth. The second insider secret is that valuation is kind of more of a justification process and much more of an art rather than a science. What I mean by this is that, you know, at the very beginning, we would try to, as independently, as fairly as we can, value Medtronic, in this case, their assets and what we thought they were worth. But, you know, after we do all that valuation work and we get into the bidding process to sell the assets, then it's not like we're going to be like, hey, this buyer bid way too much. We think that you should sell for a lot less, you know? And so basically, if someone bids higher, then what we would do is kind of adjust our assumptions in the model to basically be able to say, yep, we can justify you basically selling your assets for this much. So what this also means is that if you're on the buy side, meaning you're trying to buy an asset, then I do think valuation is a lot more important. And basically, you don't want to overvalue what you pay because then you'll get a bad return on investment, right? But if you're on the sell side, like most investment banks want to be, then basically you're able to just do the valuation work to get a baseline of what your assets are worth. And then the rest of it's really left to what the buyers are willing to pay. The third insider secret is just that announcing a deal may not be as interesting as you might think. Basically, as an analyst, you're working on these really high profile, intense transactions, 80 to 100 hours a week. You're putting your heart and soul into every day, and then all of it culminates into finally announcing the deal and releasing the press release. And the announcement gets made to all the bankers in your firm, and you get a bunch of emails saying like congratulations from your colleagues, from people you know, and also sometimes people you don't know. After, you might get a few days off, and this doesn't mean that you don't go into the office. It still means that you're going, and maybe instead of leaving at midnight or whatever, you're getting off at like 9 p.m. or something like that, and you don't have as much work. But if your group and firm has good deal flow, this usually means that after a week or so, you'll be staffed on another transaction and the whole cycle will repeat itself. And so if you have done or closed a lot of transactions, then pretty much in your second year, announcing a transaction feels pretty good for like the day. And you also get to, you know, like slap it on your resume or like put it on your LinkedIn or whatever. But you know, that's pretty much it. I will say though that usually if you work on pretty interesting transactions, and usually interesting means larger deals, then I will say that you definitely learn a lot. Like for this example, just working on that entire LBO analysis and being able to listen on calls from upper level management teams at these really big firms and a lot of like senior level people at JP Morgan, like all this stuff was a super, super great learning experience. And you know, if you want me to share actually some more about the deals that I worked on, I do have a lot more that I have worked on. And so if you want me to make more of these types of videos, then please let me know in the comments. All right, so before I let you go, I did want to let you know that I'm giving away 5% of my June 2021 YouTube earnings. If you look for this picture of Warren Buffett in my Instagram, then you can check out the instructions there. It's super easy. And I'm also giving away another 5% to high school and college students. If you check out my description below, it's like a small little scholarship grant kind of thing. And as I've expressed in my previous videos, I give away $10 to the first commenter and to a random comment. So here are our winners today. Just DM me on Instagram if that's you. You can also get $10 in free Bitcoin if you sign up using my links down below in my description for Coinbase or Gemini. And you can also earn some free stocks if you use my links for Webull and Moomoo. And also don't forget that 25% off for Financial Edge if you're interested in that course. And all of those are in my description below. Lastly, just as always, thank you so much for watching. Hope to catch you in the next video. Thanks so much and peace out.